Why are we listening to this again?
It's your new theme music, Mr. Soldier Boy.
Okay, it's Soulja in the song. It doesn't have an ER. That doesn't matter. Just don't call me that again, okay?
But you were a soldier last week.
Not in a hula sort of way. I was out there shooting soldiers.
You shot soldiers?
With a camera.
What caliber?
Okay, I'm turning it off.
Wait! Oh.
Look, Zach. Interwebs. I love serving our soldiers who serve us. But I also love being here with you guys, giving you a great show. And speaking of, the Xbox and PlayStation made the top 10 list of coolest brands. Ray's back in the tech workshop talking about Mac and how they will be supporting the Pro again. And Zach. What are you talking about?
Sylvester Stallone has left the Expendables, and Schwarzenegger's gone now too.
You're watching RAMtv. Children have proven once and for all why they aren't allowed to vote. In a study commissioned by Google to find out what the coolest brands are, both the Xbox and PlayStation made the top 10 list. Children from ages 13 to 17 voted Xbox as a cooler system than the PlayStation. I shouldn't be surprised by this failure. These munchkins use the word fire to refer to things that are cool. Fire. What a dumb phrase. Try something cooler like da bomb. These tiny tots ranked the Xbox as number 4, following YouTube in first, most likely because of RAMtv, Netflix in second, and Google as a brand in third. PlayStation ranked in as number 7. Millennials, that is people defined between the ages of 18 and 25, according to this survey, said PlayStation was cooler than Xbox. Way to finally do something right, millennials. Good on you. This study proves once and for all why we don't let people under the age of 18 vote. They might make the wrong decision. Not that we did any better this time around. Sorry, kids. Also in this survey, some of the coolest games include Pokemon, duh, it's fire, Minecraft, where you can make fire, and Zelda, Breath of the Wild. Sorry, I've got no fire puns here. Additionally, AR and VR are seen as some of the coolest tech today, along with smartphones and iOS specifically. But before we get into things I really don't understand, let's give Ray a call and see what's going on in the tech world.
It's me, Ray Palamos, and I did miss you. I know we didn't have a RAMtv last week, but I'm back, and let's get into it. So, if you're a professional that uses Mac, you will know that Mac and professionals haven't really agreed with each other for the past few years. The Mac Pro was last updated back in 2013, so that's too long of a time for professionals to be using their computers, especially if they make their money from these computers, from the software on these computers. So what Apple is doing is they recently said this week that they are going to refocus their efforts on the Pro market, and that a Pro version of the iMac will be coming later this year, and that supposedly a Mac Pro and a new Pro display is being in development right now, and it should be released within the next couple of years. I think that's a great idea. I think Apple does need to refocus on that aspect. I know Macs as being for the editors, for the photographers, for people who do music, and everybody else could just use Windows, it's perfectly fine. But that's shifted. Now the Mac is like a luxury product. Their most inexpensive computer with a screen, so besides the Mac Mini, is still $900 for the most cheapest that I, at least I could find. But yeah, and let's get into the next story though. It's that Spotify is now gonna restrict some albums to Spotify Premium users only. So as part of a new deal with the Universal Music Group, Universal artists have an option to keep their albums and only albums locked to Spotify Premium users for up to 2 weeks. Of course, the singles from the album will be available for everybody, but the albums will remain a 2 week exclusive for Spotify Premium users. This marks the beginning of the end of Spotify having all the music that anybody could hear and going more in line of Tidal and of Apple Music, where exclusivity does matter. And of course, Spotify is still one of the biggest, most successful streaming services anywhere. If you talk to someone on the street, they probably will know what Spotify is, like people know what Netflix is. And it's going to be interesting. We're going to see if Spotify is going to go into the exclusivity wars that Tidal and Apple Music have fought, where Apple Music has the Drake exclusives and Tidal has the Jay-Z and Kanye West exclusives. And we'll just see. And my name is Ray. I totally forgot. Make sure you turn on your HTTPS and make sure everything that you do online is encrypted, so that way when the ISP sell your browsing history without even telling you or asking for permission, you at least could have some secrecy, or not even secrecy, you have your privacy when you use encrypted services. And maybe the ads that they tried to target you with aren't going to be so specific to you. But yes, my name is Ray, and I'll see you all next week. Bye.
Alright, so I have a confession to make. I try my best to keep up with the nerd movie culture, but despite the fact that announcements apparently came out like a year ago, I had no idea Dwayne The Rock Johnson was producing a movie adaptation of, well, this. In fact, when I read a story on April 1st about how some people were coming on board, I assumed it was an April Fool's joke. Seriously. Not really sure where to begin with this. Video game to movie adaptations are something I usually am vehemently against. I love the stories in games, but they're usually butchered terribly in the translation. Resident Evil and Silent Hill are some of the worst offenders, in my opinion. And if you're wondering why I didn't include, like, Street Fighter or the Super Mario Brothers movies, that's because those games barely even had a story of any note to build off of. Rampage falls at the absolute bottom of that spectrum. Literally an arcade game where you get to live out a King Kong or Godzilla fantasy of a giant ape, lizard, or werewolf monster named George, Lizzie, or Ralph, respectively, rampaging through the city. Rampage had enjoyed video games across 18 years that all amount to the same thing. Grab your favorite overgrown super monster and turn the city into a parking lot. Now, how this is going to amount to a movie, I don't know, and what details I do have don't really help. Brad Peyton, the director behind San Andreas, is the one at the helm of this. I don't know how typical this is, but the original script is by Ryan Engel, and it's already went through 2 rewrites. Dwayne Johnson stars as, from what I hear, an animal lover who's the only one who can take down the monsters, and is backed by a cast that so far is including people like Naomi Harris, Marley Shelton, PJ Byrne, Jack Quaid, and Brianne Hill. The roles are not yet defined, some of those names you may recognize, some you may not. Now here's one you may recognize. Joining the cast now is Jeffrey Dean Morgan, known most famously these days for Negan on Walking Dead, and he'll be playing someone named Agent Russell, an attitude-slinging OGA government official. Johnson promises the movie will be emotional. Frankly, I have a hard time seeing how a movie based on a game where your character can get hot loogie as a power-up is going to take me on an emotional roller coaster. Now some of you may be saying, Zach, this isn't fair, you're crapping on this movie way too early, you haven't even seen any footage. Frankly, I'm aware there's no footage, that's why I'm playing this over the old video games. And yeah, you're right, technically, but the truth is, I have zero hope for this. The movie is slated for a 2018 release, so hopefully, in a year's time and maybe some trailers and some more information, I'll end up eating my words. But for now, I think this one's going to be a rampaging disaster. In the world of movies that don't suck, we're experiencing some pretty sour news. The Expendables, starting in 2010, gave us a fun thrill ride as we watched an amalgamation of history's most famous and infamous action stars putting together one last hurrah. Except one last hurrah turned into 2 and 3 more last hurrahs because, frankly, they're terrific hurrahs. And because hurrah is really fun to say. Hurrah! Sorry. And hurrah is the last word to describe the fact that Sylvester Stallone is off the project now. About a week ago, Stallone officially left the project over prolonged disagreements with Image and Millennium head honcho Avi Lerner. Disagreements on director, script, pretty much everything, to be exact. That doesn't mean Stallone won't iron out his differences, but for now, Rocky's out. What makes this suck even more is the fact that Arnold Schwarzenegger is gone now, too. About a couple of days ago, Arnold put it simply, "There is no Expendables without Sly. I would never do the movie without him." Now, like I said, Stallone may come back, which means Arnold may come back, and even if they don't, Expendables 4 may be made without them. Still, no matter what silver lining you try to paint, that sucks. All of that in mind, Lerner has gone on the record saying that he and Stallone agree on about 95% of things, and that he's not ruling out Stallone from returning. He feels it can be made, and the series is not dead regardless. What do you think? Without Stallone and Schwarzenegger, would you bother with an Expendables 4? Let us know what you think.
Thanks, Zach. If you like what you saw, make sure to like, subscribe, and share. Don't forget to hit the little bell so that you're brought up to date every time we have something new published on YouTube. Of course, don't forget we have our GoFundMe page and our widely spread Patreon page. I say widely spread because I really, really, really need you guys to spread this around. It's a brand new page. We need your help. We really appreciate all the support and love we have from you guys. We really could not do this without you. So please, 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 if you can, go to either that GoFundMe or Patreon page. Donate in any way you can. Again, Patreon only charges your wallet every time a RAMtv comes out. Of course, we do a RAM, Tiny RAM, every single day, Monday through Sunday, with the exception of Saturday, because Saturday is where you're going to join us next week for another episode of RAMtv. And next week, we have a special announcement we'll be making, so make sure you join us and watch on Monday's Tiny RAM, and I'll give you a little bit more of a hint as to what's going on. Do you RAM?